Hello. How are you, Bubba?
How you are doing?
I'm doing fine. How you are doing?
It's a beautiful day.
Gorgeous day.
It's a beautiful day. Yeah. I'm having a very nice time.
Well, that's good.
Jay.
That's good. Jay.
I have an announcement to make, because some people don't know this. The winter session of Possum Racing starts at the Tucker Possum Racing Complex tomorrow.
Is it that time of the year again?
Yes. I will be driving the pace truck. And, the big breeders from all around the country are bringing in their possums.
Right.
It's just they have new stables and everything. It's just going to be fantastic, and I want everybody to come out for the possum racing.
It seemed like only yesterday that the season was over, and here we go again. Well, that's
yes,
great.
And you were the announcer, the honorary announcer and
yes.
starter last
right.
year.
Right, yeah.
It's just going to be fantastic.
Well,
I love the possums. I love to watch things run.
I know that, and possum racing is of course catching on, and if we ever get pari-mutuel betting in this state.
It will be incredible.
That's
incredible.
No telling how much.
Out there, they love it.
Think about the revenue that'll bring in.
Oh, Jay.
Any big names you can mention this year?
Well, there is a possum called Native Waltzer.
Native Waltzer.
Jay.
Yeah.
Looks like the favorite to take everything this year.
The possum.
We'll be running in the big stakes race.
The possum to watch.
Jay. Yeah. And there's another new possum called is Man O Argument.
Man O Argument.
Jay. Really fast little fellow. Got them little beady eyes.
Yeah, yeah.
And got
fire in his belly.
Oh, Jay, got the fire in the belly.
Yeah.
That's the phrase.
Yeah,
that's the phrase, Jay.
I love it.
Well, the other thing, and it's a ways away, but there's a new thing going to happen in Atlanta. It will be the first place for stadium fishing.
Really?
Jay.
I love it.
They're going to have a big bass tournament in January at the Fulton County Stadium.
That's great.
They just fill that thing out with water, block all those little holes, and block the exits, and then they fill it up with water.
Stadium fishing.
And them guys come in there with their boats, and they have a big bass tournament.
With big prizes, big bucks, I imagine.
Oh, Jay, it's going to be big.
I love
thing.
It.
Yeah.
I love it, Bubba.
So those are just a couple of things in the world of sports that those other people don't talk about.
That's exactly right, and that's the reason you are the best.
That's right. I am the best, which brings me to a little point.
Okay, a poem?
No, point.
Point, point. Point.
I don't do points.
Okay.
No, you got somebody doing points.
Okay.
No, this is my own stick.
Okay. Your gig, right?
That's right. I think because I am on the staff now,
mm-hmm.
I need an office.
Need an office?
Jace, I think so. I think so. In fact, I would like to be allowed to come to the station to do some reports, and they won't let me in. They keep saying, call on the phone.
Well, I think you're right. You should be here.
I should be there. I should have an office, have one of them little things, with my name on it, sitting on the desk.
Right.
All of those things. I'm looking for, I think the word is perks.
Perks, that's the word.
Jace, I'm looking for that. I am a professional. I am a mature broadcaster.
Yes.
And I don't think I'm being treated fairly.
No.
And if management doesn't want to do these things for me, give me an office, give me a little nameplate and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Then I'm going to have to come down there and do some serious cutting. That's all. You tell Bob Neal.
I will tell him.
I know where he lives.
Okay. Well, when you put it that way, I tell you what I'll do. As soon as I get off there at 1 o'clock today, I will go in and tell him about your demands.
That's a good idea. I think you should do that. Just go in there and throw a little tantrum, slam around. You are my friend.
Uh-huh.
And you will do this for me, and I will repay you.
I will take care of that, I promise. And the next time we talk, I'll have some kind of status report for you.
Okie dokie. And by the way, just I don't want this to seem like a payoff or anything, but freebies for the possum races for you.
Oh, thank you. Really?
freebies, the whole season.
That's wonderful. A season ticket to the... I can't stand it. All right, listen, depend on it.
Okay.
All right.
Play the music, Miller.
Play the music, Miller. He also, he also gives us out cue.
Adios.
Adios. The one and only Bubba Martinez. Uh-oh. Speaking of one and only, could this be Dick Freimeyer?
You have got him, old friend.
How you doing, buddy?
Pretty good for an old plug this morning.
Well, good. Did you find your way out of the North Georgia mountains all right?
Yes, without any trouble, but it was foggy, rainy, you name it, it was doing.
Yeah, it was not a good weekend, but next time you come, we'll have a better view for you. Get those clouds out of the way.
That's absolutely right. Well, we got a few problems this morning.
Well, let's solve them.
Well, Jeff's bothered with a chest cold. Now, Jeff, all you need to do is drink a half a cup of raw sauerkraut juice once a day for 5 days. That'll take care of your chest cold. And, Martha, how can I stop static shock in my carpeting? Well, Martha, if you'll mix one part fabric softener with 5 parts of water and just put this in a mist spray bottle and spray this mixture over your carpet, you'll find this will take care of it. And Al has a small crack in his wood stove that's permitting small amounts of smoke to escape. He wants to know what to do about that.
Yeah.
Well, just mix some wood ashes and salt together, and then just rub that in that little crack, and that should stop the crack.
Wow.
Now we got the football.
All right, football.
Georgia by 1 over Florida.
Way to go.
But the Falcons are going down. San Francisco is going to sock it to them by 14 points.
All right.
Well, it looks like, old friend, that's got us for this week.
All right. You have a great weekend.
All right. Just don't forget to crow now.
I'll do it. You hang in there. Good to hear from you, Dick.
All right. I'll see you then.
All right, buddy.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. The one and only Dick Freimeyer, 61 degrees, 16 and a half minutes after 11 o'clock at AM 750 WSB. All right, 20 minutes after 11 o'clock, and we're going to talk to Mac. Mac, you're on the radio, pal. Mac?
Hello.
Hi there, how you doing?
Fine.
Good, you're on the air.
Hello.
Hi there, you're on the air, Mac.
Oh, good. This is actually the Scotsman, Ludlow.
Oh, good to have you.
I just got back with my wife for a visit to Scotland and Ireland. We were down in the southeast of Ireland. We'd never been there before. This is where they made the movie Ryan's Daughter. I'm sure you remember that.
I do indeed.
Beautiful country.
I envy you. I'm sure you had a good time.
We certainly did. Now, look, being the anniversary of, as they call it over there, Armistice Day tomorrow.
Right.
I wonder if your listeners could help me out. There is a poem that was written at the end of World War I by a Canadian soldier, and I only know the first two lines. In Flanders Field, the poppies grow, between the crosses, row by row.
Right.
If anyone knows how I could get a copy of that, I would be deeply grateful.
Now, Bobby Harper recited that poem this morning on the morning show.
Yeah?
Bobby will probably know how to get a copy. If somebody doesn't call in, don't despair. We'll see if we can't get you one from here.
Okay.
All right?
Thank you so much.
You take care.
Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.
Bye-bye. And let's see, who's next? I believe it's Ricky. Hello, Ricky.
Hi, Ludlow.
Hi there. How are you?
Hi. I just called. You know, I haven't talked to you in a long, long time.
It has been a while, Ricky.
Yeah, and I wanted to tell you that I've brought my show back to town, the great Ricky Wilson Elvis Nostalgia Extravaganza, and I'm going to be doing my Elvis impersonation at Wilbur's Suds Shop.
Yeah, Wilbur's.
Yeah, and I just wanted to tell you that. I you know, I mean, people are always seeing my Elvis impersonation and saying, gee, how does he do it? I mean, it's uncanny.
Yeah.
You know, he sounds.
Yeah, you hear, that's the thing over and over you hear. It's uncanny. I've caught your act.
Yeah, it's a gift. What can I tell you? It's a gift.
I think you need to do this for Ricky, because I know that you want to, normally I don't get into free commercial things, but Wilbur Sud Shop needs all the help it can get.
Yeah.
And I want to see you a big success, because you're a local guy.
Oh, thanks.
And yeah. Why don't you, Why don't you just give us right now a little preview of your act as you prove once again that you are one of the all-time great Elvis impersonators.
Yeah, well, this is one that everybody knows and everybody likes, and you know, and people are always saying, "Oh my gosh, this is uncanny." Here goes. I don't have my guitar.
Certainly, I realize this is short notice.
You know I love you, baby. You know I love you too. Don't be cruel. Two hearts, it's true.
Ricky.
And then I just fade, you know, I sort of fade that into love me tender.
Yeah.
Love me true.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it sort of gets you, doesn't it?
Well, you're right about one thing.
Yeah.
It's uncanny.
Yeah, and people just, they see me in the costume and everything, and they say, my gosh, you know, you put 50 pounds on that guy and he would be on.
is there a cover charge at Wilbur's Sud Shop?
No, no cover, no minimum.
Just walk right in, buy a beer, and enjoy.
And enjoy an evening of fabulous entertainment, taking you back to the time of the great and famous and wonderful the man himself.
And when do you open at Wilbur's?
We'll be opening tomorrow night.
And how long is the run for, Ricky?
It's an indefinite run. It's an open booking.
All the way through supper is what you're saying.
At least. And I'll be doing all of the King's great hits.
Well, speaking for myself only, I wouldn't miss it.
I'm hoping that you'd be out there.
Listen,
I'm really hoping you would.
We've got to go, but could we fade out with a little bit of Hound Dog?
You ain't nothing but a hound dog. Crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. Crying all the time. You ain't never caught a and you ain't a friend of mine.
Uncanny. Listen, break a leg.
Well, okay. Okay.
I'll see you at Wilbur's Sud Shop.
Okay.
I wouldn't miss it.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Ricky. It'll certainly be standing room only for that, I promise you. Ricky. Atwater, you're on WSB.
Good morning, Ludlow.
Good morning, my friend. How you doing?
I'm a regular listener, usually in my car every day, but I'm usually not able to get to a phone, so I just enjoy listening to your show. And
thank you.
It's always entertaining.
Thank you, sir.
I wonder if you mind my throwing my two cents in. I especially liked your show yesterday where you were talking about the bad men of the movies.
No, we'd love to hear about it.
Well, I didn't hear anybody mention one movie that I've remembered, I guess, since I was a boy that I thought was a guy in there was a real bad man. It was Richard Widmark.
Oh, yeah.
And the old movie Kiss of Death, I think it was about 1947 or 48, where he pushed a crippled lady in a wheelchair down a flight of stairs and laughed about it.
Yes, indeed. He played a gangster named Tommy Udo, and that one part, that one scene there with that laugh, made him a star. Overnight, he became a star.
That thing gave me chills when I saw that. I couldn't believe him I could be that evil.
Oh, and then enjoy it.
Oh,
yeah.
He was a fantastic actor, so then when he did a turnaround and started playing good guy parts, it's hard to picture him as a good guy after that, but I was impressed with that. I thought that had to be the most evil man I ever saw in a movie when he did that.
I don't think there's any question about it. One of the classic scenes ever. It was Victor Mature's mama, too, if you
That's right. Victor Mature. I think Brian Donlevy was in it. And it was a real good oldie movie, but it was that hysterical laugh he had that I've never heard anybody do a laugh like that before, and he was fantastic. Another great bad man, and we don't think it was a bad man, was Jimmy Cagney.
Well, Jimmy Cagney was one of the all-time great gangsters, I think.
Oh, my gosh, he was mean.
Yeah.
So I was enjoying seeing what people were coming up with yesterday. A lot of people, they call in their different types that I never even thought about, but it was real interesting hearing that, different people's picture of what they considered an evil person.
Right.
And, it was a lot of fun. Another thing I'll throw out at you, they mentioned some of the cowboy bad people. Somebody mentioned Bob Steele. Bob Steele, of course, goes back to silent movie days. And one of the greatest trick rider movies I've ever seen many years ago, and I've always wanted to get a copy of it, was Bob Steele doing a test shot. I don't remember whether it was Monogram Pictures or who did it, but it was a silent one where he was doing trick riding on a horse, and I've never seen anybody do trick riding like he did in that particular scene I saw. As I say, it was a silent, it was a test movie that they did for him years ago, but he was absolutely fantastic. He was one of the few riders I've seen that would go underneath the belly of the horse at full gallop, come back up the other side. He could turn around and shoot backwards. And he did everything under the sun you can imagine on the horse. Of course, he's a little tiny guy anyway, but he was unbelievable.
You know, I have seen the same kind of thing, but it wasn't Bob Steele. It was Tom Mix, who would sit backwards on the horse, tip his hat to the camera. Great, great stuff. So a lot of those guys knew what they were doing.
Yeah, Steele, of course, got into being a stuntman and everything else later, but I've told people about him going underneath the horse full gallop. They said it was impossible. I've always wanted to get a copy of that.
Yeah, I don't know where it's available. Now, listen, I have sat here and run slap out of time. We thank you for your good comments and hope you'll call us again soon. It's 11:28.
Going to try a long field goal. McFadden, long, long, long. Good, good, good!
This is Larry Munson. Atlanta Falcons play San Francisco this weekend.
How's it going?
Oh, great. I'm
good.
Obsessed.
Wonderful, wonderful.
It gets any better. I can't stand it.
I know it.
Man, I've come up with a couple of trivia questions. I just got to ask you.
All right, you've been laying in the bushes waiting for me, haven't you?
Yes, sir, Betty. What was Jack Palance's first name?
Walter.
Shot me down again. All right.
All right.
All right. All right, you remember the movie Sands of Iwo Jima?
Yeah.
Okay, when it came out, how many surviving members were left at that time that put the flag up on Iwo Jima?
Wow. I'll remember that. Was it three?
She got me again. One of them was Ira Hayes, of course.
Yeah, right. Who died not long after that, as I recall.
Yeah, he did. Sure did. Not very long after that.
Right.
I got to ask you another question.
All right.
I was watching the old rerun the other night of that movie. What did the M stand for in Striker?
I don't think it ever told. If it did, I don't remember.
I watched it, and I never did hear it, but I thought maybe somebody might have been in the book or something.
No, I don't. I've never heard it, I don't think.
Well, you know what I'm doing right now?
What, you cooking some more barbecue? Last time we talked, you were fixing the best barbecue in the South.
Oh, yeah, well, bud, that's done been it and gone.
Gone, gone.
Long time. I'm fasting.
You're fasting?
Yeah.
Trying to get rid of that barbecue?
No. See, I'm getting ready for my steak dinner. And, you know, after the Tech Georgia game.
Oh, yeah.
You do remember that?
Yeah, we've got a steak dinner on that, didn't we?
Yeah, right.
Okay.
And I want to get down real thin. Of course, I know you got a problem with thin folks.
Well, I'm not sure that you're not going to starve to death between now and the Georgia game.
Oh, no. You know, I'm doing this water diet.
How does that work?
Like PBR and vodka.
That kind of water diet, yeah.
You know, that's the greatest drink you ever put in your mouth is vodka. You know, Dick Freimeyer's one told me about that.
Oh, really? Tell me about it.
Well, you take potato juice and you put it in your blender and you get it just like it's juice.
Uh-huh.
And you pour your shot of vodka in there and hit it with a little potato juice.
Uh-huh.
Out of sight.
What does that do for you?
I mean, well, it's supposed to take care of your ulcer while the vodka's tearing it up.
Yeah, I don't think I'd recommend that for an ulcer at the juice.
Well, I don't do too many of them.
You have a great day, my man.
Okay, buddy.
I'll talk to you soon. Good to hear from you.
Yes, sir.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Dan, you're on WSB.
How you doing, Ludlow?
I'm doing fine, Dan.
Well, that's good. You know what amazes me about some of the wackos you get calling in?
Yeah.
I was down at this country disco the other night, and they had a song down there that just amazed me.
What was it?
Have you ever heard a country rap song?
I've heard, yeah, Jerry Clower does one.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, this one here, I was down at this club, and it amazed me. It just kind of fell in line there, and it's a kind of a legend song. You want me to say it to you?
Yeah.
All right, here it goes. Milton Crabapple was a son of a gun. He plows his fields in the noonday sun. When the day is over and the hard work's through, he retires to the barn with that goddamn mule. He ran for the sheriff of Crabapple Town. Now all the crooks and thieves won't come all around. He walks the streets at night, and his steady eye is true. He's got his trusty backup. It's that goddamn mule. As his legend grows, and oh so far and wide, you mess around in Crabapple Town, he'll skin your hide. One thought I want to leave you with, and it is so true, watch out for that backup, it's that Calderon mule. I mean, it's the truth, what can I say?
I love it, Dan, I love it, buddy.
I just thought you'd like to hear that.
Take care of yourself.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
872-0750, let's see, I believe Mandy is next on our list. Mandy, how you doing?
Hello. I'd like to stand off about something a little different.
All right.
I'd like to sound off about a recent article that appeared in the Atlanta Constitution, I believe. And really, I think it'd make a good topic maybe a little later on. But basically, well, the article was written by Ernest Hollins, Democrat senator from South Carolina. And basically, he said that the best-kept secret in Washington is that President Bush does have a plan for reducing the deficit. The key to the Bush plan, the Social Security Act. Well, I'm sure that Mr. Bush is not dependent on Social Security for his entire existence. And really, this money was set aside when it was created. It was set aside solely for Social Security. And the taxpayers had no voice in this national debt. And I think we all recall a few years ago that there was so much in the paper about the Social Security was about to go broke. And of course, they have had the increases in the Social Security tax, and also at the time they were there was so much in the paper. I understand that they put millions of federal government workers on Social Security. In other words, they reduced their retirement and started taking out Social Security tax on them, which means there would be millions of federal government workers drawing Social Security when they retire.
What does Senator Hollings say that?
What he stated was that they would have in 1990 alone $65 billion excess, and then another increase in the Social Security tax would bring it up to $99 billion by 1993. But they claim, with all of the surplus, they don't have enough money to pay these people they've been cheating for years, these people born from 1917 to 1921. And the money was put in the Social Security for the Social Security, and if we have that much excess, I cannot see bothering that. That is the taxpayers' money.
Okay, let me see if I can put your mind at ease a little bit. Number one, I don't know what Senator Hollings had to say about the gap babies, those folks who are being cheated that you just mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
But we need to remember that it was his party that did that. Let's put that on one side and remember that that was the Democrats that did that. And then if anybody dared to do anything, to deal any blow to that Social Security fund that turned out to be fatal, to in any way disrupt it or cause the people not to be able to draw their checks, would be absolute political suicide, and everybody in Washington is a politician. So I don't want you worried about that.
Well, I understand that, but that still wouldn't put any money in our pocket if it went bankrupt because Washington was being cleaned out.
Well, let me tell you something even more worrisome than that. The whole government's bankrupt.
Well, I agree with you on that.
And we can't do anything?
I'm not blaming the government for everything like
yes,
some gentleman said before that people were prone to.
I know what you're saying, but you just don't want to lose what you bought and paid for.
That's right. The money was set aside for that and solely for that. And I still think that the people should write their senators and representatives and tell them they're opposed to that money being used for anything but Social Security.
That is always a good idea, and I would agree with that 100%. I got to go, my friend. I'm glad you called, and you take care of yourself. Hey, make plans now to attend the 54th annual Georgia Tech Junior Varsity football game Thursday, Thanksgiving Day at Bobby Dodd Stadium right here in Atlanta. Tickets are $10, and proceeds benefit the good works at Scottish Rite Children's Hospital. For more information, call 885-9900. A reminder from the station that cares, AM 750, WSB. A little acid indigestion. I don't want to hear that, Cyril.
Well, you know, sometimes I just feel like I can pull my heart out to you.
Well, you can, but I don't want to hear about your personal physical problems on air.
Sometimes I think about you, not in the same vein, but kind of like Dr. Rigasaki to a certain extent.
I see.
You know, I could just pull my heart out, you know.
Yeah.
And I need to tell Dr. Rigasaki about my acid indigestion, though.
Yeah, I tell him about that.
And tell you about Bunny.
Yeah. I don't want to know too much about Bunny now.
Yeah. Well, you know, I had just made all kinds of plans back earlier. You know, I had bought some tickets and stuff, and I was going to take the Grief Ladies, and we was going to go down to Jacksonville this weekend. And
yeah.
But with all the problems that I've, you know, that I've accumulated over the last 3 or 4 weeks, I'm just, I'm not going to be able to quite, I'm not quite physically up to it.
Well, you can't, why don't you get them to take you into Hearst?
Well, I could do that, and I have gone down there into Hearst before.
I know you have.
And, in fact, what, 2 years ago, there's, we took about 7 or 8 folks down there.
I'll never forget it.
And we just had them sitting up in the back there, and, you know, people just looked at us, but we made it.
Well, are you going to be in town this weekend?
Yeah, I have all anticipation of being around this weekend.
Well, let me tell you why I ask. Because my good friend and beloved colleague, Dave Folk, is sitting here right now, fixing to tell us about something that's going to happen this weekend. And he had just mentioned, honest to goodness, before I punched that line up, that he wanted to get you involved in this. Say hello to Dave Folk, Cyril.
How you doing, Cyril?
How you doing?
Well, I'm doing better. I hope you're doing better, too.
Oh, I'm just doing so much better. I'm almost up to eating a barbecue sandwich now.
You mean that we're talking about the barbecue sandwich that, let's see.
No, we're talking about a bet me and you made.
Wait a minute. Ludlow, these earphones have quit.
Good.
Wait. Oh, there you are, Ciro.
Mm-hmm. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, you know, I do owe you a barbecue sandwich.
No, I'm going to have to tell you something. I can't take advantage of you.
No, why is that?
You know, you and I had a bet.
Yeah.
And I lost. And then you said we was going to go double or nothing.
Double or nothing.
Well, see, the double or nothing was supposed to be on my part, so me and you are even.
Well, I'll buy you a sandwich anyway, because I'm a nice guy.
I wanted the whole dinner.
Oh, well.
the whole show.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Dave's got an invitation for you. Invite him, Dave.
Okay, go ahead.
Ciro, I know that you and your buddy there, Guadalupe, like to play soccer.
Love it.
Yeah.
You know how much I love soccer.
Yeah, about the same as Ludlow.
Yeah.
Mm, that's kind of like watching the possum races. Now, go ahead, Dave.
All right. Any of the folks down on the south side who have kids who play soccer from... All ages. This is from age 6, 7 years old all the way up. Tomorrow at Fort Gillem, following the last season game of the Clayton County Youth Soccer Association, some members of the Atlanta Attack, you know, that's the professional soccer team, will be at Fort Gillem, and they're going to conduct a little free clinic and meet the players and shake hands and autograph some soccer balls and things like that. And it's all free, and it's from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m., tomorrow at Fort Gillem.
That's nice. That was a nice public service.
I know. You know, I'm going to look in my closet and find my soccer ball and carry it over and get it autographed.
Yeah, well, if you do, I might even autograph it for you.
Would you?
Yeah.
Well, I'll be darned.
Put gold balls.
I don't know if I can stand it.
Try to pull yourself together.
I'm going to try.
Well, Guadalupe being, you know, the South American ancestry there, I would imagine he's a big soccer fan.
I thought Guadalupe was from Mara.
Well, from where?
Mara.
No, Guadalupe's from, Lord, I don't know where he's from. He's from South Los Angeles or somewhere like that. Yeah, that's where he was brought up. But he is, yeah, I have to admit, Guadalupe is to soccer what Cyril Greenberg is to the drive-in funeral home business.
Wow, that's a biggie. Cyril?
He definitely loves soccer.
I got to get out of here.
Well, go ahead. Me and Dave's got something to talk about. Well, okay. Dave, if I don't have anything, I got somebody I got to bury tomorrow, but I don't remember what time it is.
Yeah.
But I'll try to get over there.
Well, try to either push it up or delay the funeral. Come on by 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. at Fort Gillem.
I'll sure do it. If it rains, you know, I can put it off, you know.
Yeah.
But I can just tell him, folks, if I bury him, he'll just pop back up, you know.
Yeah. Oh, Lordy.
All right, be sure and tell, who is this, Ludlow?
It's Ludlow, yeah.
Okay, be sure and tell Ludlow I said bye.
I sure will.
And your mortician, he understands. Ask for the body man. Tell David said bye.
I'll tell him.
Now, we'll see you.
Bye-bye. Cyril Greenberg. That's a nice public service, and I hope you turn out a big crowd.
Yeah,
are you going to be there?
Yeah, see, I've got a game to coach. I coach a game at noon, the under-10 Tigers at noon, and then that's the last game of the season. So they're going to go down and eat pizza, and so some of them will stay there, and I'll be around.
All right, you draw a big crowd. Got to get out of here and make room for the one and only Kirk Mellish.
Thanks, Luddy, for today.
E11. Hello, Jane.
Ludlow.
Yes, ma'am. How you doing?
Good, thank you.
Good.
I was riding past the Courthouse Square down in Lawrenceville when your caller that was requesting the Flanders Field poem called in, and I noticed the flags flying and the signs of patriotic observance, but one thing that I didn't see and one thing that I missed is someone selling the poppies.
I haven't seen those in a number of years. I wonder why.
Well, I think they're still being made, and I don't know why, but the reason that I connected the two is that the poem in Flanders Field was the inspiration that led to Miss Moena Michael, a Georgia lady, coming up with the idea of making those poppies.
Mm-hmm.
And this happened right in the closing days of World War One, and she was at that time working in the YMCA and Soldiers Relief out of New York, but she's a native out here in Walton County. And from the time that she was inspired by that poem, she, of course, wore her red poppy the rest of her life, and the ones that were made by the disabled veterans, by the time she died in 1944, they had already generated over $200 million worth of aid from the sale of those poppies to aid the disabled veterans.
Wow.
And that's still continuing, but I regret that I don't see those being sold on the street, especially in Georgia, especially in this area where...
There was a time just a few years ago when everybody you met had one on.
That's right. And as a Girl Scout, as a youth, we were put out on the street corners and sold those poppies. And there's a monument to her on our state capitol at Georgia. There was a 3-cent postage stamp with her image. There's a lot, but yet the thing is, if we don't continue to remember that those disabled veterans of all wars are still making those poppies, and it's for their benefit, we're not living up to our end of the bargain.
I couldn't agree more. Got to go. Thank you, my friend.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. We'll get out of here and make room for all the news, and then right back with some more conversation. Stick around now. Enjoy the news. $1,000 with the phrase that pays for details. Listen to Atlanta's Morning Show and the Kathy Fishman Show late afternoons on AM 750 WSB, and write it down. The time at the tone is 12 o'clock.
Get twice the coverage with exclusive Skycopter Skyplane traffic. Depend on AM 750 WSB Atlanta.
Good afternoon. I'm Mike Summers in the AM 750 WSB News Center. The temperature at 12 noon, 65 degrees, blue skies and breezy, low humidity this afternoon, the high near 68. Cobb County officials say there might be one fatality in last night's crash of a Navy jet fighter in Smyrna. The missing person lived in one of the more heavily damaged units of the Pine Village Apartments off Windy Hill Road. We get the latest from WSB's Elaine Wooten.
Officials now believe one person may have been killed in this disaster. Medical examiner Dr. Joe Burton says they will now begin going through the debris to try and confirm that.
We're dividing up into six teams now, including people from Public Works and the Navy crash site investigation team. And we'll be going through all the debris and the rubble this afternoon. We feel like there's a very good probability of at least one victim being in here that is not accounted for at this time.
Dr. Burton says all the other residents they were looking for have been accounted for except that one person. Heavy equipment has been brought in to help clear the debris, and a team of Navy investigators will begin searching for and tagging parts of the aircraft to try and determine the cause of the crash. In Smyrna, Elaine Wooten, WSB News.
The Navy jet slammed into the ground only seconds after its pilot ejected. He and two people who were on the ground are critically injured. A fourth person suffered less severe injuries. The search in the building rubble resumed just before dawn, with 6 5-member teams of local and Navy officers slowly retracing their steps from last night. The Navy team from Norfolk, Virginia is on its way to inspect the crash site. Information Officer Kerry Henry tells WSB what they'll be looking for.
They'll come and they'll check the site, and they'll try to determine if they can reopen the property for the residents that do live here. They'll also start measuring, tagging, identifying parts, picking them up, packing them after they photograph everything.
Again, Cobb County officials believe there might be one fatality in the crash last night in Smyrna. East Germany has announced that its open border policy will stay in effect permanently. The announcement by the East German Interior Minister caps one of the most dramatic shifts in post-war Europe.
giving the once pent-up East German people full freedom of travel for the first time since the Berlin Wall was built in 1961. Meanwhile, Bulgaria's official news agency announces the resignation of Bulgarian President Todor Zivkov. Both as Communist Party leader and as president, Zivkov has been in power for 35 years. The Centers for Disease Control here in Atlanta says the number of cases of gonorrhea might be on the rise. The rate for homosexual males with gonorrhea has tripled in some areas this year. Fire on the Georgia Tech campus this morning. Security officers say everybody got out okay at the Sigma Alpha Epsilon fraternity house on 4th Street. Fire broke out around 3:30 on the second floor of the building. Heavy smoke poured all over Midtown from that early morning fire. AM 750, WSB News Center Time, 12:03. Just ahead, some new figures from the Convention and Visitors Bureau, plus the weather from Atlanta's only full-time radio meteorologist.
Thanksgiving is a time of tradition when friends and family get together to enjoy a day of celebration and, of course, a huge feast. Kroger would like to be a part of your Thanksgiving tradition. That's why they've been stocking up on all your holiday needs. What better way to begin your feast than with a big, delicious turkey cooked to perfection? Kroger has frozen Carolina Grade A turkeys, 18 pounds and up, just 39 cents a pound. That's right, only 39 cents a pound. And better yet, a pop-up timer is included. Just to make things easier this year. Now you can be assured of proper turkey preparation. And what Thanksgiving feast would be complete without all the fixins? Kroger has everything you need to complement your turkey dinner, including cranberry sauce, celery sticks, rolls, dressing, gravy ingredients, and much more. Kroger is pleased to help your family celebrate Thanksgiving with big savings. Go Krogering for a feast everyone will remember.
My name is Hightop. I'm an inspector, a shoe inspector. I work for Shoe City. I was working an undercover shift in this ritzy shoe boutique when suddenly I caught a glimpse of her out of the corner of my eye. She didn't recognize me. May I help you, ma'am?
Yes, young man. I need some athletic shoes for my children.
She didn't fool me for a minute. She looked old, she looked familiar, but I knew she was dangerous. How many kids, ma'am?
247 at last count.
Uh-huh.
Actually, there are so many, I don't know what to do.
It was her, all right. She has a place downtown, a house shaped like a shoe. Maybe you'd like these, ma'am. They're expensive. She took the bait.
I'll take them.
Don't get caught spending too much. Shoe City has today's most popular athletic shoes. Nike, Reebok, LA Gear, Converse, Jordache, and more at the guaranteed everyday lowest prices in America.
But, Inspector, I'm an old woman. I live in a shoe. With so many children, what was I to do?
You should have gone to Shoe City, ma'am. With the money you'd saved, you could have moved uptown into a nice boot.
Shoe City, for the guaranteed everyday lowest prices in America.
South Clayton Street next to Bell's, Lawrenceville.
AM 750, WSB News Center Time, 12:05. Following a lawsuit by the Atlanta newspapers, the Convention and Visitors Bureau released this morning some financial records involving its top officers. WSB's Carrie Browning was there.
The records show ACVB President Ted Sprague makes over $185,000 a year, but Convention and Visitors Bureau Board Chairman Spurgeon Richardson says Sprague is worth every penny of that and has dramatically improved the Bureau in his 7 years in office.
I mean, you just don't open up hotels downtown and restaurants and attractions and you get all this business coming in. It takes a lot of hard work and it takes a lot of good expertise in order to achieve what we've been able to achieve.
The files on the finances were released after a ruling by the state Supreme Court. The Convention and Visitors Bureau budget is over $9 million, with about a third of that coming from taxes. From the Convention and Visitors Bureau, Kerry Browning, WSB News.
Investors are holding the stock market to a gain as trade resumes after a one-hour delay caused after fire broke out in a building housing computers that are used on Wall Street. It was quickly brought under control. The Dow Industrials, meanwhile, are up 16 points to 2620 in very light trade of 56 million shares. The time is 12:06. Join Atlanta's best radio news team here at AM 750 WSB. When you see news, give us a call. Our number is the same as our name. Dial WSB NEWS. Now, Atlanta's most accurate weather with WSB meteorologist Kirk Mellish.
Temperatures about average today, above normal this weekend. My exclusive forecast, blue sky and breezy with very low humidity, a high of
12 o'clock. Let's get right back to our phones. WSB Radio.
Like, gee whiz, man. Like, you have a lot of poets, poetry-like.
For sure.
Like, I do poetry. I'm hip to that whole poetry scene.
Are you really?
Yeah, like with bongo drums and wearing a beret, like.
That's touching. Are you, are you prepared to do some of that for us today?
Yeah, this is a poem. Yeah, like by Jack Iliac.
Do you, by any chance, have your bongos with you?
I don't, man.
That's a shame.
It's driving me nuts, man, you know?
Yeah, well, go to
it. The cosmos has spoken. It engulfs the screamers and overturns my dreams. Some call it blackness. Others say, wait till Roberta sings. When you tremble in a quandary and you've heard the grackle cry, look out upon some essence and track the weeds of shame, man. You've stored up mighty power in the bosom of a net. I can feel the thunder, but a cord has run through the whole thing, man. Like the game's gonna happen tomorrow in the city of monstrous regret. We'll find the porcine bladder where the halcyon charms go.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah, man.
What's that about?
It's about 12 lines.
Okay,
man.
I got it. I liked it.
I did too, man.
Did you write that?
It got me excited, man.
Did you write that?
Yeah, man. With a pencil.
Oh, good. Do you remember writing it?
Let's see. I think I wrote it about 3 days ago, man. Or else I wrote it this morning.
Well, that's close enough.
Yeah. Or was it tomorrow, maybe? Man, I'm going to write it now.
That's
the one I'm going to write.
Call us back when it's finished.
Huh?
Will you call us back when it's finished?
Oh, yeah, man, I will. And then I'll get my drums and...
Oh, yeah.
Man, this will be cool.
Yeah, you need the drums to impact a poem that.
Yeah, you'll be so hip to this gig.
Yeah, you take care.
Hey, man, I gotta.
call us back. Bye-bye. Judy, you're on WSB.
Good morning, Lolo.
How are you, my friend?
Oh, I'm just swell.
Well, good.
I hadn't talked to you in about 2 weeks, and I needed a fix.
All right.
The weekend was to get here.
Bless your heart.
I heard you one time read the thing on the radio about all I really need to know I learned in kindergarten.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever get that book?
Oh, yeah.
That is the best. I'm sorry, Lolo. You write nice books, okay?
Yeah, no, you're right. That's a great, great book.
I keep his book along with yours in the reading room. right next to the big lavatory.
Yeah, well, you're right. That's a great book, and I have perused it many times.
Yeah, I was looking at one this morning. Can I read one on the air?
How long is it?
It's about 23 lines.
Why don't you just summarize? Reading on the air is pretty boring.
Aw. Okay. It talks about a man going to see his rabbi, and he's real down, and he's very depressed. And his rabbi tells him, after pondering, he's asking for some advice, and he says, what can I do about this? My life is just a failure. Even half the time, I don't succeed in what I'm doing. And the rabbi thinks and scratches his head, and he tells him, my son, I give you wisdom. Go and look on page 930 of the New York Times Almanac, the year 1970. And the man scratches his head and goes away. And he comes back, and he's looked at it, and the headline on that page says, Ty Cobb, .367 batting average, the greatest slugger of them all. So he asked the rabbi, he said, is this what you wanted me to read, Ty Cobb, .367? The rabbi says, that's right. He didn't even bat 500, so what do you expect to do?
I love it. I love it.
The last line is the best part. It says, theology is amazing and holy books abound. I wish you'd do some more of these on the air, because I think they translate real well being read over the air, like the one about the lady that runs into the spider web.
Good stuff. Yeah, I will. I'll do that. That's a good idea.
Yeah. Miller was asking me some questions when I called today about your show and about what I like on the radio, and I forgot to tell him the one thing that I love about WSB more than anything else, and that's Kathy Fishman's laugh.
All right. I do too. We'll add Kathy's laugh. Kathy goes all to pieces. I love it.
When she laughs, it just makes me feel so good all over. I mean, it's kind of like medicine.
Kathy doesn't laugh, she explodes.
She does.
Yeah.
She does. She's wonderful. I really do. I never did like anybody else on the radio except you. But I'm going to tell you, I love Kathy's laugh. So if you just kind of put her on a laugh track on your program, you could stay on the air all day.
I'll do that. That's great. It's a great idea. I got to run, my love.
Bye, dear.
Talk to you.
Love you.
Bye-bye. Love you. Ricky, how you doing, pal?
What's going on, Mr. Lolo?
I don't know it, buddy. You been doing all right?
I've been doing fairly good.
Well, good.
Hey, today is a great day for the Marine Corps.
Yes.
And I'm a recon Marine.
All right.
And just want to say Semper Fi.
Semper Fi and happy birthday.
That's it, buddy. And I don't get a chance to call you like I'd like to, but I am still there listening. And like I told Miller on that little questions he asked, don't do nothing different. Just keep going like you're going.
Bless your heart.
All right, I've got to run.
All right, hang in there, Ricky. Always good to hear from you, buddy.
All right, bud. I'll talk to you as soon as I can.
All right, pal. Bye-bye. And we have, Miller, you want to do birthday anniversaries? Okay, we have some fine birthdays. Dan Hansen is 16 today. Steve Haddon is 40 on Sunday. Scott Preble is 5 years old today. Carol Lee Bryant is 30. And to those folks and everybody else out there having birthdays, I hope this is a great one.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Talk to Ludlow, dial 872-0750. That's 872-0750. Now, here's Ludlow.
All right, welcome back, gang. Gorgeous, gorgeous day. It has eased up about 66 degrees now. We're doing some problem solving on AM 750 WSB. Let's get right back to our phones and talk to Virginia. Hello, Virginia.
Hello, Ludlow. How you doing
I'm
there?
I'm fine, thank you.
I need to talk to the grandmother with the hyper child.
Good. Go right ahead.
Okay. Last week, I saw without doubt the most astounding video I have ever seen in my life. I went to an allergy seminar downtown here, and they had a video of a controlled test that they made with a child. He was about 5 or 6 years old, and he was sitting there in the beginning of it, you know, just calm and smiling and talking. And they gave him a small glass of just plain orange juice. Within 15 minutes, that child was a screaming, twisting, violent child. And when his mother picked him up, you know, he arched his back and was hitting her and bit her and everything else.
The sugar,
and
I guess.
Then they dropped X number of drops of this extract that was an antidote or for this allergy. And within 15 more minutes, here were this nice, quiet child again. Not overly quiet, you know, but just a normal child again. And they had identified this allergy to orange juice. And, you know, by giving him the orange juice, they had brought it on, and then they had shown what they could do with this antidote. And it was just so amazing to me, I couldn't get over it. And I would definitely tell that lady to take her grandson to an allergist. I don't even know any, so I'm not pushing allergies. But to look into this thing, because it was just astounding, absolutely astounding.
Well, I promise you that their pediatrician will know an allergist. And what good advice. I'm really glad you called. I hope she's still listening.
I hope so, too, because it could make all the difference in the world.
Sure. Hey, thanks
okay,
so much.
I enjoy your show very much.
Thank you very much, Virginia.
Okay, thank
bye-bye.
You. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Let's talk to Jenny. Jenny, you're on WSB.
Yes, I was going to tell Kathy what Cotton Eye Joe is.
Oh, good.
That's a dance in Texas.
A dance?
Uh-huh, that's a dance that they dance in Texas at the, like Billy Bob's and things like that.
Yeah.
You know?
All right.
And maybe someone else can explain a little bit better, but it's maybe similar to square dancing.
Yeah.
But it's Texas dancing.
All right.
Yeah.
Very good. I knew that somebody out there would know.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Bye-bye. Carl, you're on WSB.
Hey, Luddy.
Hi, buddy. How's it going?
It's going all right. Well, that woman, she just stole my thunder. I was going to call in and tell her where Cotton Eye Joe is. It's not done in Texas, though, only in Texas. It's done mostly just throughout the West in general.
Tell me a little bit about it. Is it like a square dance?
Luddy, I don't really know. You know, I just got back from that beautiful state of Montana, and I know that when I went in those places to drink and dance, I didn't know how to do any of these fancy things. And if you don't know how to do them, you just might as well stay seated.
Well, did you know how to drink, Carl?
Yeah, I knew how to drink, and I knew how to talk with a George accent, and that's all you need to know how to do to draw a crowd.
Okay, buddy. Take care of yourself.
Take care. Appreciate it.
Good to talk to you. Let's talk to Lee. Lee, how you doing?
Good morning, Ludlow. I'm fine.
Good, good, good.
I know you're having a good time up in the mountains.
It's beautiful.
And I had a good time reading your book, Ludlow.
Well, thank you.
Can I just do it till I need glasses?
Yes, ma'am.
And I really cracked up about Floyd and Pig up in the tree, I tell you.
All right.
Ludlow, on your other books, do you write about Pig in your other books?
I think that may have been the only book where I wrote about...
That's the only one.
Well,
it is written. I really enjoyed the book, and it's funny, and the tribute in the back is real interesting.
Well, you're mighty sweet. I appreciate it. I'm just glad you enjoyed it.
Oh, and I'll share it with my friends.
Do that now.
Okay, Ludlow, have a good day.
Thank you, ma'am.
And keep writing.
I will. Well, I got one to be out in a couple weeks. Be ready for it.
Okay.
I think you're on line four.
Yeah, probably so.
Miller said we're having a little problem with line four this morning, but we'll get that fixed for you.
Okay, I've got a couple problems maybe you can help me with. I live in the Athens area, and I cannot find any of the Merle products up here.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wondered if you happen to know of a store in this area that would carry them.
No, I don't offhand, but let me just say this. Go in and ask about them, and pretty soon they'll all be up there. They're spreading all over.
Okay. Because I've got a problem with spiders and scorpions that I need to get taken care of.
I think. Now, I'm not sure, but I think that they're going to be in all A&P stores.
Okay.
So get somebody to send you a care package from Atlanta.
All right. That's what I'll have to do.
Right,
and this is another little problem. This involves my old 4-year-old grandson. Well, he's almost four. He has got two problems that we can't seem to do anything about. One of them is teeth gritting when he's in his sleep.
Yeah.
And the other one, he refuses to blow his nose. We offered him everything in the world, but he just will not do it. He's had a sinus problem, and I think part of the problem is he won't blow his nose.
Yeah.
And I wonder if anybody could give me an idea of what we could do to offer him something or anything to entice him to do something like that.
How old is he, Mac?
He's almost four.
Uh-huh. I don't know. Let's see. Somebody out there may have had that same problem.
The other problem that could go clear up, but the teeth gritting has got to go. I mean, he can honestly, he'll lay there at night and sometimes for 30, 40 minutes and just continuously gritting his teeth.
Yeah. I don't know.
Well, you have a good one, Ludlow.
Well, you keep listening, Mac. We'll find out how we can help that young man.
All right. Thank you.
All right, buddy. Bye. Take care of yourself. It is 21 minutes now before 11 o'clock. At AM 750, WSB. Welcome back, gang. 11:32 now at AM 750, WSB. And we've been talking about teeth grinding. And we had one caller that called and said that it was, you know, that they outgrow it, no need to worry about it. Another one called back and said it could be devastating. We have on the line with us right now a dentist friend, Dr. Ken McMillan. Dr. McMillan, how are you?
Good morning. How are you doing this morning?
I am just fine, my friend, just fine. I hope you all set to put in your 2 cents worth on this, because I want to hear from a dentist, and we got one.
Well, I tell you, grinding of teeth for children is normal. You do not want to alter the pattern at all. Now, if they get to be, you know, 16, 17 years old and still grind their teeth and have all their permanent teeth, and then you can make an appliance to stop. The woman was partially right. It is very devastating to the dentition if you grind your teeth as an adult or as a, let's say, a 18, 19, 20-year-old. But not on a child. They're just losing their teeth. They've got new teeth erupting. they're growing, and it's just normal pattern.
And there's, not, number one, nothing you can do, and number two, nothing you should worry about.
You shouldn't worry about it. You shouldn't do anything at all about it.
But if you got one that's in the mid-teens, then it's time to talk to your dentist about it.
That's right. If there's some other problems besides just the noise, if there's some pain and there's some headaches and there's neck aches and other things associated with myofascial pain problems, then you need to consult your dentist.
All right. From the horse's mouth, so to speak. Dr. McMillan, you're very kind. We appreciate that very, very much.
Sure. Have a nice day.
Okay, my friend. Thanks a lot.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right, I think there we have it. Then kind of a common sense approach to it, too. Let's talk to Clarence. Clarence, you're on WSB.
Hello, Ludlow.
How you doing?
I got a question for you.
All right.
I got a little problem. I loaned a piece of equipment to a friend of mine, and he tore it up. Ain't it his responsibility to have it fixed and return it?
Oh, I would think so. I don't know about legal responsibility, but I would think of... there's certainly a moral responsibility there.
Well, is there any legal responsibility there?
It could be.
How would I go about checking into that?
Well, I think maybe you need to... how much money are you talking about here, Clarence?
Well, we're talking about a bulldozer.
Oh, so you're talking about a bunch of equipment. Did you rent it to him?
No, I just loaned it to him. I own it. It's a private-owned dozer.
Yeah.
And I just loaned it out to a guy to do some work in his own property.
Yeah, how much damage you think there is to it? If you had to guess.
Really, I'm not sure, but at least $300 or $400 worth, if not more. It depends on what all's wrong with it.
Well, does he admit breaking it?
Oh, yeah. Matter of fact, he didn't even tell me he tore it up. I went to get it to use it one day, and I cranked it up and found out there was something wrong with it, and I shut it back down and went and asked him what happened. He told me, oh, it tore up last week. Wasn't even
going to
tell me about it.
Yeah, I think probably there's some legal responsibility there. I'd give my lawyer a call and give him all the circumstances and ask him, you know, what's the best way to go with small claims court by yourself, or what's the best way to go?
Yeah.
This guy hadn't offered to pay for
it? He said he was going to fix it, but it's been sitting there ever since.
Well, he's a heck of a friend because...
Really?
You would think he'd want to jump right on that because he may need to borrow it again. Plus, he ought to value your friendship enough to want to...
Well, tell you the truth, Pat, I didn't want to tell you, but it's actually my brother.
Yeah. Well, sometimes brothers will take advantage of brothers.
Oh, yeah. And, I hate to cause any stink about it, but I can't afford to have him tear something up and me pay for it to have it fixed.
Yeah.
Especially when he's borrowing it.
I understand what you're saying, but are you talking about $200 or $300?
At least.
Yeah.
Because there's a knocking in the engine that needs to be fixed. And I've already spent $6,000 on this vehicle replacing the engine, rebuilding
right.
it myself.
Right. Let me tell you what I'd do if it was me. And this, you know, this is going to vary from family to family or
right.
whatever. I'd go ahead and have it fixed. And then I'd send him the bill and make sure he had an itemized bill on it.
Mm-hmm.
And say, I know you want to take care of this because here's what it cost and here's the bill. Please send me your check. I'd do that before I got any hard feelings stirred up,
mm-hmm.
because and then if he ignores that, then there's time to take whatever action you feel like you have to take.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I appreciate it.
Okay, buddy.
Thank you.
Hang right in there.
Okay. Bye.
11:37. We're going to talk to Catherine. Catherine, how you doing?
Ludlow.
Yeah.
The gentleman that called this morning in regard to his telephone directories, he couldn't find anything.
Right.
Had 100 books and couldn't find anything.
Yeah.
I happen to be a retiree of Southern Bell.
Oh, wonderful.
And I was very upset about this, so I called. I want to refer him to the business directory. It says on the front cover, business, including government listings. You turn the page over on the right-hand side, the second column, it says... Customer Guide Index, so. Then where to call? And the number is 780-2355, and he will get help. He can tell them everything that he wants to. And the telephone company also told me this morning they are aware of this problem. They are working on it, in other words, to consolidate. So that you won't have to call this one and call that one and another one.
Yeah.
So that's good news.
Well, whatever happened, Catherine, to the idea of the white pages and the yellow pages, and what was wrong with that? Because that seemed to work just dandy.
Well, it goes back to the divestiture, which you've heard of.
Oh, yeah.
And that is when the government said, you've got to do this, you can't do that. It changed the whole thing and complicated everything. So now, Bell South, which is Southern Bell, and South Central Bell, which consolidated, made Bell South.
Right.
It's made all these changes necessary, and it's computer.
Boy.
And so I'm very happy to know they are aware of it, and they are working on it. So
the government filed things up like Hogan's Goat.
I agree.
I expect everybody at the phone company agrees, too.
Well, yeah, and of course, when the divestiture came into being, a lot of the Southern Bell people were at the age of retirement, so we got a lot of new people.
Uh-huh. Oh boy. Oh, boy, do you.
So you tell him to look. Well, he can write this down if he happens to be listening.
Business directory.
Yeah, I didn't bother to get out the residential directory. I didn't know what his problem was. I heard him mention yellow pages, and he couldn't find anything anywhere.
Yeah.
So this will give him help. And tell him just to open the front of the book, and he will read where it says where to call. But rather than bother with that, he can call that number.
780-2355.
Right.
All right. I hope he's still listening.
I do, too.
Catherine, you saved our life. Thank you.
Oh, good. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right, listen, I want to tell you now about Merle's Home Products. You know, now you got a crowd coming over for Thanksgiving. You know how they are. They're going to be checking every nook and cranny. I want your house to look sharp when the crowd gets there. I want you to have tried by then the some of the fine Merle's Home Products that you can use around the house for cleaning, like the furniture polish, dynamite stuff, glass and mirror cleaner, foam surface disinfectant and cleaner, all top-notch stuff. Let me tell you about these. If they don't do what they say they do, they're going to do. If you're not completely tickled about this stuff, you get your money back. That's the way the folks at Merle's Home Products operate. And they got a new location for you. You can find the Merle's Home Products for you folks down in the Old National Highway College Park area at the county market down there. They are right now handling Merle's Home Products. And, of course, future stores, Cub Foods, and this product is effective. All these products are effective, and they're spreading, and pretty soon everybody's going to have it. If they don't have it at your grocery store, you ask them to get it. It's Merle's Home Products. And a few folks down on Old National in that area, the county market now has them. Stop by there. Clean that house up just right. Furniture polish, glass and mirror cleaner, foam surface disinfectant and cleaner, all dynamite products, and they're from Merle's Home Products. Turtle peanuts. Or does anybody out there know what turtle peanuts are? Surely to goodness, in the state of Georgia, we're going to be able to answer any question existing about peanuts. Lady called trying to find them. Turtle peanuts. Any help for that? Also, the gentleman called from Florida this morning, had some rust in his clothing. Washed his clothes, or his wife did, washed his clothes with a coat hanger in one pocket, or a piece of a coat hanger. Know how to get that rust stain out of there? He's going to call me when he gets back in town. I sure would like to be able to help him. So if you have any idea, give us a call. Our number, 872-0750. And Carl called, wants to know the shape of, I guess it's I-20 between Raleigh, I-40, I'm sorry, between Raleigh and Wilmington. How much of that is completed? Some of you traveling salesman guys up and down the expressway ought to know about that. So give us a call on that one. I think we found out all about our teeth grinding, and we had the call from the Atlanta Gas Lights. I think we're getting in pretty good shape. So give us a call with your problems or with one of your solutions. Our number, 872-0750, 1-800-WSB-TALK. Now, our Knights of Columbus roast tape, I want to plug that very quickly. We'd like for you to have a copy of that. I want you to, you've heard all these folks getting after me. We played the little cuts on them. We're playing some more of those cuts. But you might want to hear a little bit about how I retaliated on this thing. This is from the roast tape.
Absolutely true. You don't have to write anything about Dave Folk. Just follow him around. Dave told me that he was going on one of Dr. Cooper's diets. It's been several weeks ago. And he said, but I changed my mind and thought better about it. He said, I'm just going to cut back on fried foods, and I think I can lose enough weight eating fried food, not eating fried foods. So that's all I'm going to do is going to cut back and not eat any fried foods. Remember this, Dave? Yep. True story. Yep. Yep. One of our listeners, a dear lady, came by the station, and she brought for all the staff a huge pan of homemade chocolate eclairs. There must have been 200 chocolate eclairs on that thing, and they looked great, and they were just dripping chocolate. True story. I walked in the newsroom just as Dave was biting a chocolate eclair in half. And I said, boy, Dave, it's a damn good thing that's not fried, isn't it? Here's the way you get your copy of the roast tape. Some very, very funny people on there. Dave Folk, Scott Slade, Mary Moed, Kathy Kirk, Milton Crabapple, Ciro Greenberg, Paul Gonzalez, Bob Neal, they're all there. All this money goes to proceeds. The proceeds of this money go to benefit George's mentally retarded. So it'd be a great cause and a great gift for somebody. Make your check. $10 per tape, payable to the Knights of Columbus, and send it to me, Ludlow Porch, WSB Radio, Atlanta, Georgia, 30309. And please write tape on the outside of the envelope, and that way we'll get it in a proper hopper and get it right out to you. So you do that. This is very important. We'd like to sell a lot of these tapes and raise a lot of money for George's mentally retarded. So you do that. I would consider that a personal favor. Let's talk to our friend John. John, you're on WSB.
Hey, Ludlow.
How you doing, buddy?
Good. I hate to be repetitive as far as stains today. I'm just wondering if anybody has a concoction to get tobacco stains out of clothes.
Tobacco stains?
Right. I used to chew tobacco. I don't anymore, like on the golf course. And I tell you, if you get a little spot on one of your shirts and you wash it, it just spreads all over the shirt.
Business picks up. I have no idea, but somebody out there is going to know how to do that.
Okay.
Have you tried everything so far?
Tried everything.
Nothing helps.
Nothing helps.
All right, buddy. We'll find out for you.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Bye.
Tobacco stains for John. Anybody helping? How about Roy? Roy, you're on WSB.
Good morning, Ludlow.
Good morning.
How you doing?
I'm fine, partner.
Good. Beautiful day out here on 85 to be driving around.
It is gorgeous.
For the last 3 weeks, ever since you played Jerry's Breakdown, I have been trying to find it. I've got a daughter who lives in Nashville. She scoured Nashville, Ernest Tubbs record shop and everything. And I'm about to have a fit to get that tape.
You know, I'm not even sure where that came from.
Well,
I don't know.
I don't know either. There was a guy on there that had it was a McNeely, seems to have been a part of one of those tapes, but it was on a tape. The best I've been able to learn was on a tape by Chet Atkins and Jerry Reed. And it's obviously an older tape.
Yeah, let me do a little checking and give me a day or two and check back with me.
All righty.
I'll see what I can find out for you.
I sure appreciate it.
All right, my friend. Take care,
sir. Yes, sir. Bye-bye.
It is E1151. Let's check in again with Kirk Mellish.
Thanks.
62 degrees now, 10:42. Open line. What is on your mind? We're going to get right back to our phones and going to go down to Barnesville and talk to Mama. Hello there, my friend.
Ludlow, Ludlow, Ludlow.
How are you doing?
Great, dear. Listen, I'm not any good on doing impressions, but something has happened that has made a tremendous impression on me.
Okay.
I am home.
Boy.
From the nursing home, hospital.
Wow.
All these 11 or 12 weeks.
Wow, big day for you. When did you get home?
Friday afternoon late.
Well, that's
mm-hmm. a happy day.
That was kind of a Christmas present for you, wasn't it?
Oh, Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's Day, and birthday, everything wrapped in one.
Bless your heart. Well, you've had a tough time. I'm glad you're home.
And but guess what?
What's that?
Making strong plans for the 20th.
All right.
Okay.
All right.
Just tell me one thing in regard to, is it level, everywhere level coming in if I have to use my walk-off wheelchair?
Yeah.
Everything's level.
Yeah, Stouffer Waverly, they got plenty of access, and you'll be in good shape.
Okay, dear. You know, one time you had it fixed up for me to bring Cynthia, you know, and had it set up to come to the theater around, and
you made
arrangements, so I just wanted to check with you to be sure in case I had to bring one or the other, which I will.
No, it's just not going to be a problem, so you just come on, and we'll be looking forward to seeing you.
Guess who I had a lovely letter from that wants me to share it with all of you?
Who is that?
Our crap-up-old friends out in Yakima,
yeah.
Said I could bring it and share it with you all if you want me to.
Sure, do it.
I'll do it. I'll bring it. Whatever you want to do about it, we will.
Well, she's a dear lady, and I have...
I know. We all loved her so dearly, and she's just always so much joy on your program.
Well, she's still a part of the Wackos, even though she's in Washington State.
Of course. Well, looking forward, dear. I don't have anything, but that's the best news I can give you.
Well, that's very good news.
I do want to say again, if you'll give me the moment to over the air, because it's so hard to try to reach everyone by trying to write them, and I don't know just who all I will get to see up there. My heartfelt thanks for our family, Wacko family of friends who have been so wonderful, wonderful, wonderful in cards, messages, gifts, love, lovely flowers, just everything, prayers of all things, the prayers that have been offered for me, because through God's mercies and all the prayers, I'm sure that's one of the strongest points of my being where I am today.
Well, we are glad to have you back home, and we're really looking forward to seeing you on the 20th.
Thank you, my love, and we're looking forward to it with great joy and anticipation.
All right, you take care of yourself.
See you, my dear.
Talk to you then.
Bye-bye.
872-0750, 1-800-WSB-TALK. Anybody out there got any gnat bites? Anything driving you crazy? Let me tell you what a gnat bite is. A gnat bite are those little things that you know should not bother you. Many times the gnat bites are something that are none of our business, and we know intellectually that we should be able to go our way and not worry about it. But you can't, because they just drive you nuts. Gnat bites. Those are the things that turn us all into potential murderers. The gnat bites. 62 degrees. Our number, 872-0750, 1-800-WSB-TALK. Song here worse than Fluffy, and you play it. We hate to do that, but sometimes you just have to be disciplined. Our number 872-0750, 1-800-WSB-TALK, and here he is, the Sawdust Kid. Hello, big boy.
I'm telling you, I just won my merit badge.
Yes, you did.
Sure. I am now an official member of the Ludlow Rescue Team.
That's right.
Son, I thought you were doing good this morning.
We were. They all went away at once.
Oh.
Yeah.
Mercy. Well, I'll tell you, I've enjoyed hearing these guys, and these, I guess you call them blasts from the past, but they're new guys to me.
Oh, yeah. Well,
what was his name?
The old vaudevillian.
Yeah.
Yeah. How many guys you know play mouth for a living?
That's a bad thing to ask me, son, because I know a lot of guys that run their mouth for a living. Is that the same thing?
Yeah, but be careful. You're stepping on my toes. Listen, while I got you online, I want you to say hello to some special folks, because we happen to have some scholars from the journalism class at Chattooga High School in Somerville here with us today, and we are glad to have y'all. Do not confuse this with journalism. I don't want to set you back in your education. Just wanted to tell them that, so they didn't leave here thinking this was the way you do radio.
Ain't no sense starting them out with a bad example.
Exactly right. All right, you coming Monday?
Oh, yes, sir.
All right, you be
yes,
there.
Sir, what time you think I'll leave Peachtree City then? Here, about 4 o'clock.
I would think I'd start now.
We plan on starting about 6:30.
You know what you ought to do, don't you?
What's that?
You ought to come spend the night.
You going to spring for it?
I beg your pardon?
You going to spring?
We must.
Did the mic go dead?
I think you may have me confused with somebody who cares whether you live or die.
I thought the mic might have gone dead there for a second. I wasn't sure.
I thought it was earphone problems. All right, my man.
I knew you'd have a problem here, Nat.
I will see you on Monday, and I expect you to be there bright and early, ready for some hot coffee and a donut or two.
I might sneak a friend in with me.
Do it.
All right.
I look forward to it.
All right. Take care.
Hang in there.
All right.
Bye-bye. 872-0750 is our number. If you're outside...
It was too late to call in and do a talent.
No, not at all. What talent do you have?
Well, I have a part-time job on the weekends. It requires somewhat of a talent. I'm an auctioneer.
Oh, really?
I thought I could just show you how I...
You're one of these fast-talking guys
that... I will sell something, you know. It's called a talent, I guess.
Well, certainly it's a talent, yeah.
Would you like to hear me...
Listen, I can hardly wait.
Auction something. We'll pretend like I'm going to auction something.
Okay.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Now, what am I bid for this thing here? Could we start the bidding at $10? $10. There's a fellow there with $10. Could you have $15? We've got $15 here. Twice sold for $15.
I like
that gentleman over there.
Very, very good.
Yeah, it takes a lot of energy to be an auctioneer.
And takes a lot of practice.
Well, it does. It kind of comes natural to some people.
I want you to listen and see if you need to study this and see what you think about this. I'd like to have you comment. This is the way you sell tobacco, and it's just pretty much what you just did. Listen.
What was that?
Well, that's...
I heard that guy on a Tarzan movie one time.
Yeah.
He was in a boat.
He does pretty much what you do.
Yes. I can tell. I don't auction off tobacco. It's usually antiques.
I like it. I like what you do, and I think it's a great talent.
Well, I appreciate you giving me the time.
Listen, do you ever hear from any of the old gang, Harvey?
Well, sometimes I do. My neighbor Tom, he tries to keep me abreast of things.
Yeah, you hear from Tom. Well, that's good. That's good.
Well, good day to you, Mr. Boyd.
Well, good day to you.
Much obliged for you giving me the time.
Always enjoy talking to you. Take care of yourself.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. The Roswell Traveling Salesman is with us.
Well, bless my heart.
How you doing?
I'm doing good.
Good.
I'm sitting here waiting for my theme music, but...
Uh-oh.
I don't hear it.
Miller.
But
wait a minute.
Have to,
there's been an awful mistake here somewhere.
We're going to have to talk to Miller.
Oh, wait. No, wait now. This is going to be all right. It'll take about 30 minutes, but we'll get this. All right, wait. I'm gonna feel like I didn't put you on hold.
All right.
All right, here we go.
Okay.
Now, let's take this call.
Bang.
On the road again.
All right, now here he is, gang, the Roswell Traveling Salesman.
Well, how do you do, Mr.
You feel better now?
I feel right good.
All right.
What town are you up in the woods?
Peggy, I'm at home. I'm at home at the radio station.
You're at home at the radio station?
Yeah.
Bless your heart. I'll tell you what, Porchy.
Yeah.
You done fell into a bucket of it, haven't you?
Pretty much. Listen, I want you to say hello very quickly to the... journalism class, Chattooga High School from Somerville. They're here visiting with us.
Hello, journalism class. Pay attention to what Luddy's doing. It's the way it should be done.
All right. Don't you dare do it.
Now then, you having a big day, are you?
Yeah, I'm having a good old time. I'm fixing to do some serious traveling, Luddy.
Where are you going?
Oh, holy mackerel, just thinking about it's giving me heartburn.
Well,
believe it or not, I'm going to Boston, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, Detroit, Chicago, Milwaukee, Richmond, Virginia, Minneapolis, and St. Paul in a two-week period of being gone the whole time.
Wow, when are you leaving?
About December the 5th, I think.
Wow.
Then I'm going to be back February the 3rd or something like that.
Wow. Wow.
You know what? You always have, you know, Major Porch's original Cut 'em Some Slack Amateur Hour whenever I'm not at home with my instrument.
Well, what instrument do you play, Charlie?
Well, I play a little five-string banjo and guitar.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they call me Finger Salesman, my friends.
Are you going home for lunch or anything?
Am I going home for lunch?
Yeah.
No, I got to work through my lunch period because I didn't get here till 10:30.
How far do you live from your job?
Of course, I live in North Fulton, you know, just off of, on Bethany Road.
But where do you work?
And I work in Doraville, so it's a little tough.
Yeah, it's going to be tough. Well, all right. But next time, listen, I tell you what. Friday, bring your banjo in, and we'll let you play without an
official Cut 'em Some Slack Amateur Hour?
Exactly. Exactly.
I'm going to bone up.
Good.
All right.
I'll expect to hear from you Friday with a little audition.
With a little audition.
Right.
That's right.
You take care of your bad self.
You reckon Cyril will let me use the what you call girl from a backup?
The grief lady.
Grief lady.
I'm sure he would.
Because I'm going to be doing some wailing.
Listen, got to get out of here. Take care of yourself.
All right, bye.
I'll talk to you Friday.
WSB Radio Atlanta is an equal opportunity employer.
For a couple of weeks. I decided to take the MARTA up to downtown to an appointment
at
Avondale Station.
Uh-huh.
So I get to the parking lot. I drive all over the parking lot about a half an hour. The only parking spaces I could find were way in the back corner marked small cars only. Where were all the small cars? Up by the station. I feel like I'm being discriminated against because I have a large car.
Yeah, that's awful. That's awful. All the small cars were right up there close.
That's right.
That's
and not one parking place for the larger car.
That's awful.
So I parked in the small parking place.
That's
and
awful.
Fortunately, did not get a ticket. But I thought that had been annoying me, and I felt like I was being discriminated.
Well, I think you're exactly right. I think you should either take two places of the small cars or buy yourself a small car. That's awful. I sympathize, my friend.
Okay, I just wanted to get it off.
Great line. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Leeson, how you doing? Leeson in Social Circle.
Hey, hi there. Ludlow.
Hi there.
This is my first time calling. I just want to ask a question.
All right, sir.
I have a recording of the Amos and Andy show, the Amos part where he was telling the story of what the meaning of the Lord's Prayer is.
Yeah.
He made it and gave it to all the employees of Rexall Drug Company, I think is in the late 50s.
Yeah.
I still have one of those things. Is there any value to it?
I doubt it. And I'll tell you why I doubt it, because I think there are a lot of them around.
Uh-huh.
A lot of folks have capitalized on some of these radio recordings.
Uh-huh.
Get you a magazine. There's several of them. Go to any good bookstore. It's got a big magazine department, uh-huh. And it's called, they're called collectors or collectibles or that sort of thing.
Uh-huh.
Look through there and see if you can find somebody who is either selling or trading those kind of things. And get in touch with them and ask them if it has any value. Because
there
are a lot of experts out there, and somebody collects everything. And it may have some. I doubt it, but it might.
Uh-huh. Well, thank you very much. I've listened to your show and enjoy it.
Glad you called, sir.
Like I said, first call, but I'll be listening to you more.
I'll do it now. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Linda, you're on WSB.
Hi, Ludlow. How are you?
I'm great. How you doing?
I'm fine. I need your help.
All right.
You had a real nice lady that called you a few moments ago named Alice.
Uh-huh.
Well, I used to work with that woman years ago, and I have been trying to get a hold of her since we lost contact when we worked together.
Uh-huh.
And is there any way you could tell her to call you back and give her my phone number?
Yeah, I'll,
I hate to do this, but I have been trying for so long to reach her.
All right, I'll put you on hold, and if she's listening and call back, Miller will give you your number.
Oh, appreciate it, Ludlow. You have a wonderful day.
Okay, take care of yourself.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Put her on hold, and let's see. I believe old Mother Hubbard is next. Hello, Mother.
Good morning, Ludlow.
How are you?
Doing well.
Good.
You going to give Miller the day off so he can come to the party and visit with us?
Miller will be there working.
Working?
Yeah.
That won't be any fun.
Well, I'll be working. You don't care about me.
Well, yeah, but you have fun when you're working.
So does Miller.
Well, I suspected that. He must be just all arms and legs back there punching those buttons.
Miller has
little black things, you know.
Miller doesn't have as much fun as I do because nobody does, but he has a lot
right.
of fun.
I got a question for you.
All right.
I was playing Fluffy for some friends the other day, and one of them said that sounded a lot like Imogen Coker. I wondered if you'd ever thought that.
No, I haven't. I'll listen to it next time it comes around. I don't know who that is, tell you the honest to goodness truth.
I figured that. Well, I got a little gnat bite.
All right.
Every afternoon when I get through with my last stop, I stop and get a Coke and crackers. Now, that's a generic Coke, whatever's on sale.
Right,
And it's amazing to me how many of the convenience stores don't have a price. I'm not talking about one on every little item. I'm talking about you go over the rack, you look up and down the cooler on the bottom of the bottles, and you have to go up to the cash register to ask them how much it is. If you don't, they ring it up, and the Coke and crackers is about $1.50.
Yeah, you can stop and got a cheeseburger somewhere.
Right, and they got a big old stack of them out in the driveway for $1.25 for a six-pack. So you figure, hey, you know, these will be cheap. And they don't mark them.
I'll be darned. You know, I never noticed that.
Just rubs me the wrong way.
Well, it should. It should. Have you? I guess you've already spoken to management about this.
Management of what?
Of the store.
You got to be kidding. They're home.
Oh, I see.
And you got somebody there that...
That's very interesting. I never thought about that.
They're supposed to mark the rack or the shelf or something. They're not required to mark the individual ones.
Yeah.
But I had one the other day. I waited through line to ask the difference between the price of the can and the bottle.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, it just... Maybe it shouldn't bother me, but
well,
it does.
It's become a little crusade for you. I understand.
Right. Every once in a while, they tell me, you know, they ring it up to $1.50. If I'm not in a hurry, I say, no, that's too much, and walk out.
All right.
I hadn't figured out how they get it voided out of their cash register.
$1.50 for a can of Coke?
And a pack of crackers.
Oh, okay. All right.
So that's about 50 cents too much.
Yeah, all right, buddy. Well, keep us posted.
See you Monday.
All right, buddy. Look forward to it.
Okay.
Bye-bye. Linda. Linda?
Yes?
Hi there.
Well, I don't have a special talent, but I did have a dream about you last night.
All right, tell me about it.
And the secret word you had yesterday, rainbow.
Uh-huh.
I kept dialing the number, and you said, meet me at the end of the rainbow, and we'll split the pot of gold.
Yeah.
And my fingers just in my dream just kept ringing and, you know, pushing the button.
Yeah.
And, I finally got to you, and you said, I'm a little bit ahead of you, but meet me there, and we'll split the pot of gold. And you was there before me, and I got there, and you was already getting the gold out of the pot. And I caught up with you, and you said, I'll split it with me. So, that was amazing. I dreamed that last night.
Crazy dreams, crazy. Glad you called,
have
Linda.
A good day.
Take care, you sweet son. Bye bye. Tony, you're on WSB.
Yeah, hi, Ludlow. I just wanted to pass on some information for you.
Okay, Tony.
Some fun that's going to happen on this Saturday, November 18th, in Tucker. We're going to have a Christmas house. It's called Christmas House 1989. It's going to be held at St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church on La Vista Road. That's in Tucker.
Yeah.
We're going to have Santa Claus. We're going to have Santa's Secret Shop for the kids, crafts, baked goods, gift items, lunch and snacks, and babysitting. So I just wanted to pass it along to you.
And when is it?
It's this Saturday, November 18th, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m.
All right. Hope you draw a big crowd, my friend.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. It is 20 minutes before 12 o'clock at AM 750 WSB, Ludlow Porch and Miller Pope. Holding a force. Hey, need a job? The DeKalb Private Industry Council can tell you about training programs in everything from medical technology to truck driving. Find out how to qualify at 288-2103. A reminder from the station that cares, AM 750, WSB. 64 degrees. Nice song. I could get into that. Let's talk to our friend Leather Britches. Hello, my love.
Howdy! I'm just so proud to be here. And I'm just so glad I could come and say hello to you this morning, Ludlow.
That's very, very
good. You know my special talent is yours,
darling. I want to tell you, that's the best Betty Talmadge impression I've ever heard.
Well, you know, I did some voiceover work for her. I'll tell you all about it sometime. But anyway.
That's a great Minnie Pearl, isn't it?
And I were working together. And she came down here. She told me, she came down here to see what I was doing. See, I never used her name. I just said I was Leather Britches. I was Minnie Pearl's first cousin from Flat Bottom. And I never used her name because if you ever use her name, you know, you're in deep trouble. But anyway, she told me that of all the people she'd ever heard impersonate her, that if she ever got sick, she'd know who to call on.
That's a great one. That is an absolutely great one.
So, if you want me to, I'll do some of that for you Monday.
All right. Well, okay. We just buy you. Put some material together.
Okay. I will. I sure will.
All right.
And I'm looking forward to seeing you.
Well, we're looking forward to seeing you, as always.
I'll be there with my leather britches on.
Do it.
Thanks a lot.
We'll see you then.
See you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
And here is Marietta Gale.
Yes, I don't have any talent at all, but I have a little question.
All right.
Who are these Fenortners that have anniversaries every Friday?
It's Buffy and Tab.
But how many years? I mean...
15.
But you're doing it every Friday.
Oh, no, I do it every day.
Every day?
Yeah, their marriage is kind of on a day-to-day basis.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I've been wondering about that because I just couldn't figure that out, how they got on every day, every week for an anniversary.
We're just trying to help them hold a spark.
Oh, okay. I just thought there was something special about them, and I thought I had missed something.
No, I know them both very well, and let me assure you, there's nothing special about either one of them.
Nothing special about either one of them. That's great. Well, I just wanted to say I enjoy your show, and I sent off for my tapes today.
All right, bless your heart.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Take care of yourself. Bye-bye. June Bug.
Well, hey, sweet thing.
How you doing?
Oh, I'm just fine. You know what? I'm counting the hours till Monday morning.
Oh, well, I'm looking forward to seeing you.
You know, I was down at Silverhead all last week, and I was about, instead of 12-hour days, it was 15-hour time.
You need to back up and tell everybody you're talking about the Silverhead legislature.
Yes, how about it?
And what it is.
We did some great bills down there, and I was just real pleased. And when I got so tired, I was really dragging, I thought about next Monday I'll be down there with all the wackos.
That's right.
Listen, I was on the phone a while ago and heard just the tail end of, you made a remark about Sparky. Is she ill?
She's had a little setback, but she's working on it.
Great.
And we're going to make sure she gets there on Monday.
All right, I got a poem for you.
All right.
All right, now you might need this someday. I hope you won't ever need it, but here you go. Are you ready?
Okay.
Okay. See you in court. There is a new All-American sport, and it's entitled, I'll See You in Court. When you are chosen to play in this game, you get a summons made out in your name. You're given a seat and told not to budge, and what you hear next is...